They were just waiting for him to do something spectacular.
He got supporters off their seats. You know, he always knew something was going to happen.
Paul Sturrock's right up there at the very top.
He was my favourite.
In an iconic team from an iconic era, one man cut an iconic image. He was fearless then, and he's fearless now. He's taking the game to Parkinson's disease just as he took the game to every opponent he's ever faced. To some, he's Dundee United striker Paul Sturrock. But all superheroes have a secret identity.
Paul Sturrock is lucky.
Oh, it's lucky again.
He's lucky. Always been lucky, always will be.
They've been giving him a wee bit of stick lately.
Andy Rowland was a fullback who used to play for United. He was called Lucky before I got called Lucky. So he passed that nickname on to me. And it stuck. Lucky.
Do your teammates regard you just as highly as we, the public, regard you?
He is, in my memory, one of the most joyous footballers I've ever watched.
Sturrock!
A street footballer, which is how he looked.
With a sock down at the ankles and the jersey flying.
I didn't like anything tied on me, tight. You know, tight around your legs, shin pads, I couldn't handle it.
I mean, who doesn't play in shin pads these days? No one.
It didn't feel free.
It was hell on earth watching the two greatest centre-halves Britain have ever produced in McLeish and Miller sort of going, oh, it's Luggy again.
I always enjoyed giving Paul Sturrock a real strong tackle. He needed it. He was crying out for it.
Right now, I think he will. He does. That is it.
You know, there's some players you watch and you're kind of like on the edge of your seat, and you were with Luggy, but it was for the best possible reasons, because you were just waiting for him to do something spectacular.
That's a good ball, he likes him from there, that's a great goal!
It was tingly, I loved it.
That elasticity seemed to bend his whole body around the marker as if he was Steve Stretch from the Fantastic Four.
In the action hero world, it doesn't fit the format for the heroes to be led by an iron-fisted dictator, but this is a different kind of adventure.
The driving force at Tenadice is Setney manager Jim McLean. McLean, who has never come near damaging his jaw muscles in the process of smiling.
I do moan a wee bit, I'll concede that.
Hold that ball, don't do that! Kick it away, I'll boot you!
Jim McLean told us how we were going to play.
I think he was almost the antidote on field to the regimented club structure that Jim had.
Okay, come on, run!
But when you think about it, something about that structure allowed that talent to flourish in the way it did.
Over the years, I think Paul had a friendlier relationship with Jim McLean than most players.
Opposites attract, all right. So much so that McLean once set aside part of his programme notes to praise his talismanic striker.
I never read that. He ever got the praise for performing for wee Jim would be, you write their names in a stamp. I said, the wee man was vicious.
Something round the back of Haggy!
Oh, if you got in his bad books, he was some man saying, played Kilmarnock one night and burst through right down the middle of the pitch. It stumbled a wee bit, took it to the side of the goals, saying a shot right through the goalie's legs into the net goal. I got fined 50 quid because I didn't cut it back to Holtley, which was the safer goal.
Luckily, that didn't stop Luggy from scoring goals, stamped through with brilliance.
Now, Sturrock on the break. Roy Predigrew's inside and he's on the clear. When he kicks it off, and own goal. 3-0. Paul Sturrock. He caused two goals and, of course, virtually scored that third goal.
The first trophy of the 79-80 season was contested by two clubs who would rule the roost for much of the next decade. Dundee United swept aside Aberdeen to win the League Cup.
Make no mistake, I feel that this is just the first rung on the ladder.
The second rung on the ladder was to win it again the next season.
That's a header again, brilliant save, but it's in. Paul Sturrock, 3-0.
I knew it was going to be a matter of time. The team was just bubbling.
And they came to the Boyle in May 1983 with the league title at stake. United faced Dundee at Dens Park, 90 seconds up the road, 90 minutes from glory.
We all said, basically, we're not going to let this slip, we're not going to let this slip. And then the whistle went.
Milne wriggles clear, might just get the chip, and he does, he's scored! Oh, what a great goal!
I'd been injured for about 3 or 4 games and played with a hamstring strain. I think I managed about an hour, and I was taken off.
Bannon against Kelly. He saved it. That's it, though.
But I'm saying, when the whistle went...
My eyes on the referee, it's gone. That's it, the finish.
You've never seen me sprint any faster than out that dugout to celebrate.
Thousands outside, and there's a man. Is he going to smile? Come on, Jim, give us a smile. He's done it.
Well, yes, he did smile. He never really celebrated as normal people. To win the league is quite incredible.
That week in May 1983 was quite the week for Scottish football. Dundee United, champions of Scotland, Aberdeen, winners of the Cup Winners' Cup.
That season spoke to the fact that Scottish football had a much greater strength and depth than just the two Glasgow clubs.
You know, I sat down after that game and said to myself, I can't think of anybody else. The Premier League is one outside of Aberdeen, Dundee United, Rangers and Celtic. That's it. It'll be the last medal I'll sell anyway.
United's league win in 83 gave them access to the European Cup, and they stormed their way to the final four against Roma.
We're talking equivalent to the Champions League semi-final. And when you tell youngsters nowadays that, you know, Dundee United were there, they wouldn't believe it.
Rome wasn't built in a day, but it was dismantled in an hour and a half with United taking a 2-0 lead to the second leg. United were on fire, but the Italians thought they were on something else entirely.
Roma said, thought we were on drugs. That was a comment they made to a reporter. Run about that match, pressurised the ball all the time.
With a place in the European Cup final against Liverpool just 90 minutes away, United needed big performances from everybody.
We were hopeless. 3 or 4 had reasonable performances. The rest of us had howlers.
And there is Conte.
So to be that close. We could have played Liverpool in the final of the European Cup. And then to find out, the referee and the chairman, to find that out later on was quite scary.
Subsequent allegations of attempts by the Roma chairman to bribe the referee have cast a shadow, but United were architects of their own downfall.
No. You hear 20, 30 years later that what happened to the referee, I never saw it at all. I just thought we played poor on the day, which we did, but I never saw anything untowards. We should have done better.
Di Bartolome.
Never watched it since. So disappointed. It crosses my mind to watch it again, but every time I go to have a look, I switch it off again.
But there were more adventures to come. The 1987 UEFA Cup saw Barcelona come to town at the quarter-final stage.
If you asked anybody about Barcelona, you know, that is the game. Probably in my mind, subconsciously, I didn't think we could turn them over.
Would either of you like to predict the results for tomorrow night?
Nope.
Too dangerous.
Yeah. I think it's fair to say, you, as a Barcelona player, you would expect to beat Dundee United over two legs.
Polestar.
You know, they gave us a really tough game in Dundee. I think one or two of our players found it quite tough.
It's the first time any man's ever said, hey, just go for the jugular. Get out to your wingers. Wingers, don't care how many times you lose it. Go and get a step by leg. And we'll win this game.
But the United fans encouraged as the throw is quickly taken towards Sturrock. There's Gallagher. The perfect start for Dundee United.
But, you know, they deserve their victory.
Off to Spain for the second leg. Passport? Check. One goal lead? Check. Gnawing sense of deja vu after the Roma game? Nope, that didn't make it through customs.
I think four or five players that didn't play in the Roma game. This was a new team that Jim had just come brought together. I think it was a great benefit.
We make it exactly 5 minutes to half time.
Just minutes before the break, Barcelona levelled the tie at 1-1 on aggregate. And with 4 minutes left on the clock, there was plenty more drama to come.
The dugouts was where Jimmy McAnally had the ball. Jim was screaming at Jimmy McAnally to give it to me. We had I was offside, so I came back 3 or 4 yards, and Jimmy Tuck went in the way, passed it back out of the way, and kept me onside.
And I'm keeping my eye on the watch.
When I was running towards the goals, I was getting tighter and tighter because somebody was coming in from here. I said to myself, well, do I hit it? Do I square it? I didn't know what I was going to get. It flashes in your mind. I decided that I would chip it. Call her dignity. He put his head down. There was the second goal. I was a 14-year-old in Pellocry. I played for the amateur team there. Yes, it was a long way.
No, I remember they were very well organised. They were very difficult, very tough, very aggressive, and had a little bit of class in there. And I think that, you know, obviously ultimately made the difference.
The only thing lost in the annals of time was whether Barcelona manager Terry Venables tried to sign Paul Sturrock after the game.
I've heard that rumour. Lee Jim told me what had happened. I was never going to get to move from Tardis.
Well, Paul Sturrock is an excellent footballer, excellent goal scorer as well. So I think he'd have probably done quite well in Spain, but we'll never know.
I didn't miss the idea. I missed the money, but I didn't miss the camaraderie that I had with this team. I was playing with my mates. You know what it's like playing with your mates? Great.
A semi-final win over Borussia Mönchengladbach saw United reach the 1987 UEFA Cup final. They couldn't get the better of Gothenburg in the first leg and returned to Tannadice with a one-goal deficit.
Well, we played a lot of games. Remember, we got the Scottish Cup, running the Scottish Cup, we had a run in the League Cup. I'm saying that I think I was knackered.
Nielsen taking on Clark. And that's the goal which United were
treading. When we lost that first goal, it meant we were basically three. We had to score three.
Play on the touchline. Here's John Clark. Good play from Clark. And there's the equaliser.
You know, that was a big task.
And you're looking for Clark. That's towards Gallagher. And it couldn't be closer. No luck at all for Kevin Gallagher. 90 minutes now have come and gone. The referee is checking with his bench. Gunnar Bengtsson is on his feet, and there goes the final whistle. Relief for the Aces. Lennart Nielsen being hugged. They made such a contribution to the season, both in Europe and at home.
You talk to supporters this day about European ties. I can't believe what the team got up to. Some fantastic trips they had as well, you know, to all parts of Europe. And I'm glad we're not talking about the Scottish Cups.
Sorry, Paul, but the history of Dundee United in the Scottish Cup is as compelling as it is harrowing. While Sturrock and United had moments that they'll never want to forget, they had plenty more that they can't, no matter how hard they try.
The only sad thing that I felt for Paul was that he didn't lift as many trophies as me, and I say that with a smile on my face, but I also say it with a little bit of disappointment, because Dundee United were a team of the highest level. They tended to get to cup finals and then, you know, not produce the form that they're capable of.
In 1981, they lost 4-1 to Rangers after a replay. In 1985, they let slip a one-goal lead to lose to Celtic. And that was just the beginning.
I don't know how to explain it. It was all, I think, mental. I think I was affected. You know, lots of players were affected. We have to win this, we have to win this. And when you put that into a football game, you normally come out losing.
When I spoke to Jim McLean about this, he was fairly clear about the fact that he'd almost become crippled by the superstitious element. Every time they went to Hampden, they'd take a different route.
One year we went in tracksuits, the next year we went in suits.
Every time they went to Hampden, they'd take a different route.
One year we went in tracksuits, the next year we went in suits.
But he tried everything, from different socks to lucky this and lucky that.
And when that starts to build up, it's a recipe for disaster.
The game is.
1987 was perhaps the toughest to take. A week that should have brought immortality saw United lose to St Mirren. Sandwiched between those two UEFA Cup final defeats to Gothenburg, runners-up on the double.
We should have won that game. Even playing as bad as we did, I can only think of St Mirren having their only chance was the one that they scored with.
They led the 1988 Cup final through Kevin Gallagher.
Lower one this time, and Mundy! McAvenny!
But Sturrock watched Frank McAvenny's late show from the bench. Four finals in 7 years, four defeats.
The trophies that we had lost, you would like to think you've won 50%. In our case, it wasn't.
It's the one thing that probably irks everybody, not winning that medal. Sticks in your craw.
In 1989, at the age of 32, and after 171 goals in 575 appearances, one league title and two league cups, Paul Sturrock retired from playing.
Well, it was me, Jim, that actually forced the issue. He came to me and said, look, Paul, I think it's time that you basically either move on or you take a job as assistant coach. So I could have been 32, finished up playing for Alloa, and I'm not being derogatory in Alloa. I wanted none of that. I wanted to be a standard that I'd achieved. And if I couldn't reach that standard, and me, Jim, said I couldn't reach that standard, then that was it. I took the coaching job. It's the best thing ever happened to me.
Tell Gary Bowen get out left when the goal against the ball.
In his 15-year career, Paul Sturrock only played for one club manager. So, did the tangerine fall far from the tree?
He's coaching tactically, I'm saying I brought into my management. But his man management, it was always a disappointment to me that he couldn't give somebody praise.
In 1993, he became the manager of St Johnstone as he stepped out from Jim McLean's shadow.
You know, he'd obviously come from Jim McLean either, you know, so we had that kind of sort of different sort of ideas.
Right at the beginning, we did, you know, we went hill walking and we finished up doing assault courses with the army, and we challenged the traffic police to the go-karting competition. You know, we had Roddy Grant and Alan Preston up on a roof, learning how to be a roofer and that.
Electrician, roofing, mining, whatever you want, you would do things like that. Why I made sure I stayed away from standing on the roof, scared of heights.
At the end of the day, the one thing I wanted to do was people to appreciate that, you know, people do work long hours and people work for a lot less money than what footballers do.
Try to instill in these younger players, you know, work as hard as you can, and it's what Paul did and how he managed himself about people and inspire people to do better.
Paul would eventually manage the club closest to his heart from 1998 to 2000, but it wasn't the fairy tale reunion he'd hoped for.
I hated seeing my team lose, especially with me managing them. It felt 10 times worse, and I did not want to let Dundee United down, so I moved on.
But he didn't move on from his approach to dealing with players.
I've been happy the way I've treated footballers. I wouldn't have had all these players coming with me from different football clubs. It's quite surprising how many did move with me.
He signed me for Plymouth Argyle and he signed me for Sheffield Wednesday. He tried to bring me down to Swindon and then he brought me in as a coach at Southend United. He plays pool with players that he was leaving out of the team on a Friday morning. He made you feel 10 foot tall while he was breaking bad news to you. I remember him telling a player one day he was absolutely outstanding the week before, but I'm going to give you a rest. And he rested him for must have been 2 months. But the players bought into it, the players loved it, and the players enjoyed it. Hence the reason why he's had so much success.
And Luggy the gaffer had plenty of that in Scotland and down south. His speciality? Getting teams up through the divisions.
St Johnstone got them promoted. Then you've got Plymouth, two promotions. Then you've got Sheffield Wednesday, one promotion. Then you've got Swindon, one promotion. I finished up at Southend, we went to the Johnstone's paint. And then we finished up at Yeovil.
He just had a brain that worked like no other. He was just so quick, so sharp to recognise and identify a tactical change or a system change. I've worked with some top managers, Roy Hodgson included, an international manager. I've not seen a manager who could change a game or who was as good as Paul Sturrock.
And if you don't believe Graham Coughlan, just ask the Boffins. A 2012 academic study deduced that Paul Sturrock was one of the best managers in English football in terms of success relative to his resources. And in 2004, the League Managers Association honoured him as the best performing boss in any division.
I won it, but it was Ranieri who had won it before me, who presented it to me. And then Fergie had won it, Wenger had won it.
And the prize for such an accolade?
It's a clock. It's a big, heavy thing. I use it as a doorstop. It's quite expensive, actually. It was an honour to be thought of as other managers, like Fergie and all the others. First time I was at Plymouth, I picked up a cup one day from my breakfast table and my hand was shaking like that. Couldn't stop it. So I talked to the club doctor who sent me to see a specialist. And he told me I had Parkinson's.
In 2008, Paul Sturrock announced that he'd been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease in 2000.
Just couldn't believe it, and went through the YME syndrome. As the seasons have rolled on, I've got worse, but not touch wood. I'm saying it's not caught me up totally.
He was on to me about coming down as a coach, and he just asked me what was I doing the weekend, and I just said, well, I'll probably be going to a game, probably doing this, doing that. He says, come down, I said, I'm not driving all the way down to Plymouth from Sheffield. He says, no, come down, I want to have a chat with you. And I knew there was something going on. And it was a Saturday morning. He was on the training ground. He came over to shake my hand and embrace you, because you never got a cuddle off him. You'd get a handshake if you were lucky. And he walked away. His leg wasn't quite functioning correctly. And I pulled him and I said, what's going on there? And he says, well, that's part of the reason why I brought you down. And I says, what you mean? And he just says, I've got Parkinson's, and that was it. And it was it hit me like a lorry. And he's fought it ever since.
I'd say I'm chairman, disregarded me because of that. I can see the point of view.
In my eyes, he still should be involved in the game when I need advice. He's the first one I turn to, he's the first one I pick up the phone to.
And while Paul Sturrock hasn't managed professionally since 2015, the fire still burns inside.
Yeah, well, we tried to put a team together out of the village. The pitch was sorted, and we had all the changing rooms sorted. But because of COVID, we couldn't get any players to play. It was unbelievable. I just wanted to coach players. That's all I want. Just to be able to train, go on the training ground, do bits and pieces with individual. But I might still do that.
I think I've described Paul as fearless. He's faced his illness with the same courage and indeed cheerfulness that is the mark of the man.
I'm just about to take up fishing again. I've got a metal detector, so I'm going to do a wee bit of finding out if there are any doubloons in these lagoons in Cornwall. There's no cure for that. But you can stabilise it, you know, you can slow it down. I'm very, very happy that at the minute the standard that I'm at. It'll beat me eventually, but that's life.
And it's very, very hard to sit in front of a camera and sum him up what he actually means to us, but he is a special man.
He got supporters off their seats. You know, you always knew something was going to happen.
He looked like wee Willy Winky, didn't he? Jersey, not just out of his shorts, but it seemed to come down to his shins. I'll stick with that. Wee Willy Winky of Dundee United. A remarkable striker.
He is an amazing man, and I don't think that he realises just how good he was and just how much we love him.
When I'm looking back, and I'm looking back at the players that I've played against and how I measure them, Paul Sturrock's right up there at the very top when you're talking about, you know, the McCoys of this world, the Charlie Nicholas, Kenny Dalglish.
He just epitomised everything that we'd want to be as a football player. He was my favourite.
Well, I think as a manager and a coach and a player, I've achieved a lot of what I would have wanted to achieve right at the beginning. I just enjoyed playing football.